Greetings and welcome to the Sleepy Hollow International Film Festival. My name is Brian Satterwhite and I am a film composer and writer from Austin, Texas. I'm currently writing a book called The Music of Friday the 13th, which will be published in 2021. It is a comprehensive chronicle of all things related to the music of the Friday the 13th franchise, including all 12 movies, documentaries, and video games. Needless to say, I am a huge Friday the 13th fan. I'm thrilled to be here with you today to help celebrate the 40th anniversary of the release of the original Friday the 13th back in 1980. I'm going to be moderating a conversation with the composer of 8 of the 12 movies, including the original film itself, the one that started it all, the maestro of mayhem, Mr. Harry Manfredini. But before we begin, I would like to encourage you to check out the description below the video. And if you can, please consider donating to or supporting the Hudson River Valley area causes and establishments that are mentioned there. They're all very important to us. Thank you so very much. All right. So next, I want to make sure that you are familiar with the amazing work of Mr. Harry Manfredini. I spent the last year of my life and a good portion beyond that listening to, studying, analyzing and writing about the music from the Friday the 13th films, and it all started with Harry's score for the original film back in 1980. I'm going to assume that you are already intimately familiar with his contributions to this incredible franchise, but let's go ahead and get a refresher anyways. I've got a short 2-minute highlight reel showcasing Harry's music. If you haven't taken the time to listen to his score away from the picture and digest the creepy goodness that is contained inside, this will be a great opportunity. Let's roll. Amazing work. I tell you, as much time as I've spent analyzing and studying Harry's music, it never ceases to amaze me. Without further ado, let's bring him out for a chat. Ladies and gentlemen, the maestro of mayhem himself, Mr. Harry Manfredini. Harry, it is a pleasure to have you here. Thank you so much for joining us.
Hi, my pleasure.
So, Harry.
Sorry, we can't be at the actual festival because it's a fantastic place.
Harry, I want to start off the conversation today. I want to mention a simple phrase to you, and I want you to tell me the thoughts that come to your mind when I mention this phrase. Okay? Here it goes. It's been 40 years. What comes to your mind?
Oh, shit. 40 years. Seems like last week. It's hard to believe it's 40 years. And but I, you know, there's evidence all over the place that it's been 40 years, but it doesn't seem that way at all. It's all still, a lot of it is pretty fresh in my mind as to what was going on there and how I was working. And a lot of the techniques that I don't know if the word is developed, but encountered and came across still were very usable. So they stay with me. They stayed with me. So, 40 years, evidently.
Yeah. When you were first writing the very first couple cues for Friday the 13th, I mean, you had to have been thinking, oh, man, I better not screw this up. This film is going to be huge in 40 years, right? I mean, that was what was going through your mind, right?
Well, no, that's absolutely, completely, as you well know, totally wrong. When I saw the picture, I couldn't imagine anyone going to see that movie. I had never seen a movie like it, and it was just so not something that I would go see that I just, it didn't make any sense to me. But obviously, I had to say, all right, I'm writing this movie. I'm going to have to make it as good as I possibly can. I have to back up the drama and make sure everybody understands what's going on and feels the excitement that the movie is trying to do. But no, you know as well as I do that I never thought it was, I don't think anybody thought it was going to be what it's turned out to be. Except maybe for Father Frank Mancuso, the father Frank Mancuso at Paramount, who believed in this picture. And we went from there, I suppose. Huh?
Well, at what point, so throughout this crazy journey that you've been on, at what point did the first thought in your head come into play? Like, maybe this is something special, that maybe this is going someplace that is kind of crazy. Was it during the first film, the second film? At what point in the journey did that occur to you?
I think it was somewhere after I scored the first film. I think that's where I just went, a lot of people are really relating to this and really enjoying it and, you know, taking the ride that their pictures are and, you know, feeling that, hey, this is great. And you know, we always, at conventions, we always talk about how word of mouth spreads on a horror film. And a lot of times you go see a horror film and you go, like, you tell your buddies or your friends or your, you know, you gotta come and see this. And not because you want to see it again, but you want to watch them react to it. You know, it's like, you gotta go on this ride. You gotta see this, you know, and I want to watch you watch it rather than, because I already know what's going to happen, you know. So, I think it was right after we put the whole thing together and it played. It's when I felt that this is something, you know, out of the ordinary, above average, and certainly, I didn't think it would go on, you know, with you and I talking on a computer. later, but I didn't know that at that point we had something.
Would that realization have occurred before they greenlit a sequel? Was the sequel going to come into play, or was it before that even?
No, I meant like right after I finished the score, went to the mix, and we watched it, and then we, you know, there were a couple of test screenings and things. That's when I knew there was something very special about it.
Did you have an inkling that there would be a sequel, maybe even before they had a sequel?
Yeah. I kept saying, well, when they said, oh, we're doing part two, what do you mean part two? Everybody's dead. The girls were, oh, what's going on? You know? And then, of course, when I saw it, I thought, oh, I see what you're doing. You know? But, of course, because of the success of part one, and as you well know, they just said, all right, well, you've got to take everything that you did in part one and really, you know, a little more of it. Part two is going to have a story, and it still has to be pretty much the same thing. And we definitely can't lose the vocal effect that they call the Jason sound. Mm-hmm. Because Jason's back, evidently. What do you mean he's back? He's dead. No, he's not dead.
That's the beauty of writers. You can write whatever you want. That's the joy of cinema.
Right.
Well, one of the aspects of the films that I credit to its success, and I might be a little bit biased, but there's a lot of reasons I love the Friday franchise, and one of them is the music, and I've loved it for a long time, and it's kind of the pathway that has led me here to focus so much of my time and energy towards it. But the music, I think, makes the series, and it made that first film. It's quite different, I think, for a horror film released in 1980. There's a really high level of sophistication that was kind of disappearing in horror films during that time, and I think it would continue to even disappear even after that. Even John Carpenter's Halloween, which I absolutely adore. I love the film. I love the score. It's a classic score. It's like the polar opposite of the Friday the 13th score. Even though Friday the 13th, even Sean Cunningham admitted that Halloween was a model or a template to make his movie. He was inspired, hey, I want to make a horror film and make money too. So he made Friday the 13th. But the score is so different. Where Halloween is very minimalistic and simple, your score is rather complex, sophisticated. It's got a lot of elements in it that I think really has elevated the series. And whether fans realize it or not, I think that is one of the big reasons behind the success. I want to play a quick clip for everybody to kind of exemplify a little bit what I'm talking about. I think the piece that really crystallizes how unique the Friday score is, especially in the first movie, is the main title. I think it is really unique, really different. It's where the whole score is essentially a murder mystery. You score it very slowly and very stealthily, but the main titles is raucous and frenetic and wild and crazy. Let's take a quick listen to it, and then we'll come back and talk about it. So that was a selection from the main title from Friday the 13th. Harry, what do you remember about writing this piece? It's so crazy and wild. What inspired you to approach the title sequence like that?
The only word that comes to mind at the moment is in when you're doing jingles. This is great. Yeah, I'm going back to jingles in order to get to Friday the 13th. They're called donuts, where you have your music, and then for like 20 seconds of theme, and then there's like 15 seconds where the announcer talks, and then you go out with your tune. They don't make jingles like that anymore. Jingles are now 2 bars long. But what I wanted to do was I wanted to create three completely different sections, and then the final section really just deposits us into the movie. So you have to remember that the movie started out with what was a flashback. It was the camp counselor singing, and then we zoom in on it just before the girl is going to get killed. We never see her get killed, but it's like a freeze frame, and we zoom in on her. And at that point, that's where the opening credits start. So what I wanted to do was create three different things. A, I wanted to make it really, really high energy and exciting. And then in the middle section, there's a sort of like where the vocals come and there's a pizzicato. And finally, we go back to the creepiness, which was the first part of the film, where I had creepy music when we went up the stairs and into that scene with the two kids in the loft of the barn. And then, but what I used to create, and as you well know, I come up with a sound that just by sure, you know, hitting it. I love the sound of the sonority, and I could play it for it. Chord. That chord to me was sort of the essence of the overall material that I wanted to use, and also that it had this major seventh interval in it, which of course is you know, it's like the basic ingredient of a horror score. I had Bernard Herrmann, who used it a lot too. It's very dissonant in the psycho. It's really two major sevenths on top of each other. So I knew I wanted to have that, but that was in that chord. And then it was a sort of ambiguous whole tone thing about it. Although I never used the chord as what us musicians would call a functioning chord. It was just a color, and that color was the movie. And that color has permeated every Friday the 13th score that I did. The pizzicato, there was a row. I'm not even sure, did I use the row or did I just use octave displacement on the chord?
Not until part two. You did that in the main titles of part two.
I didn't do the row until part two.
Yeah.
But what I did was what they call octave displacement. So instead of the notes all together, like the first note was here, it would just jump all the way around. Sort of like it's really the same sound, but it's chaotic.
Yeah.
It's like it's coming at me from above, below, you know, all over the place. The chorus holding that particular chord, that sonority. I hate calling it a chord. It's really just a sonority. But that's what I wanted to do. I wanted to start out with the energy. And the energy is kind of weird because there's actually two polyrhythms going against each other. In the lower part, the boom, 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 boom. It's almost like a seven against the strings playing a four. And by the way, the strings are broken into that sonority, so that every time they play a note, it's just the sonority jumping all over the place. I mean, when you analyze it, it's all very simple, but at the same time, it comes off as being like, what the hell is going on?
Yeah.
Sounds complicated.
I like to use the word angular. Like rhythms are just these exactly, angles and triangles pokey out, and I love that.
Yeah, it's exactly it is. It's angular, rhythmically angular, and also sonically angular because we had limited players, so it was very you had to like pull out all any kind of trick stuff that you could pull off.
And you totally did that because you're right. You had limited players. I mean, if you have a 100-piece orchestra, it's fairly easy. I mean, come on. It's fairly easy to create a big sound when you have 100 players. But when you only have 13, which what you had, you got to know how to write music in order to create that big, voluminous sound out of only 13 musicians.
Right. Well, you know, more notes.
A lot more notes, yeah.
And, the one thing to me was that really made it, you know, above and beyond that. Really, that's where I come from. I come from classical music. I've studied classical music a long time, and that's where I come from. I'm a kind of a jazzer, so in a way, that just sort of says, you know, I can play. I have no problem improvising, and I also come from what Stan Kenton, early 50s of Stan Kenton, would rather strange music, City of Glass and things like that. And then when I went to school with Stravinsky and all those guys, all those guys, Stravinsky, you know, like my brother. But I studied them and I saw things that they were doing. So I was able to incorporate those into what I was doing. But I think the thing that really set the score off was the fact that I had said to Sean, I said, I think we only need score for the killer. Because the killer is not in the movie until real life. So how the hell is the audience supposed to know it's the killer and not the cameraman, you know? So that's where I came up with that idea. And so that every time that happened, you knew it was the killer was there, not just, you know, watching a movie. And I think what happened is the score became a character. You know what I'm saying? The score became a character. It wasn't just music. A lot of films you watch and music comes in, but it's just music. Here it was a person. It was the killer. In this case, typically letting any cat out of the bag, that it's Mrs. Voorhees. But and subsequently it became Jason, you know. They both heard voices in their head and, you know, killed people.
And I always find it cool because I don't know if people know this, but the Jason sound, the Kiki Mama sound, you make that sound in the actual film score. And so
I mean, we were on like no budget. And so I remember Sean saying, can we have a chorus? And I started to laugh because we barely had players. So I said, and that literally came from studying Pomeretsky and hearing the dynamics and the drama of his choral writing. Even though it was a religious piece that was in Polish, but just the quality of the Polish language has more consonants in it. And so they had people saying the letter K, it's pretty damn dramatic and effective. So I had to figure out a way of doing that, and I went up to a mic and we tackled it and bounced it around and stuff like that, and then lost the history, you know.
And it's funny because other people can try to do it, and it sounds like other people try. But when I hear you do it, when like just now, just a few minutes ago, when you did it, I get goosebumps because, like, yep, that's it. That's the sound. Like, because you're making the sound.
It's become almost a sound now that you actually can use in comedy movies. I mean,
you see
horror movies now, and somebody starts making that sound. It's comical because everybody knows what it is.
Yeah, it's transcended its use and it's entered into the pop culture lexicon, and it's become something completely different than it originally intended it to be.
I think it's more like Soundicon.
Let's talk a little bit. One thing that screenwriter Victor Miller told me, he said that Harry Manfredini is one of the best reasons to go to a horror convention anywhere at any time. And having witnessed this myself, I've seen your dedication to Friday fans firsthand, whether it's signing autographs, taking pictures, telling stories, and I would completely concur with that statement. And by the way, if you don't know this already, Harry has the absolute coolest autograph anybody in show business. So if you don't have a Harry autograph, get one because it is a work of art all by itself.
You get a Bill Gates one on a check. This is a good one.
I would rather have yours. It is fantastic. But you've always, since the release of the first film, you've always embraced Friday fan culture, even if you yourself don't always understand it. We've had that conversation before where you don't always get it.
I get it, and I don't get it, you know.
But you embrace it, and I love that about you. Yeah. So what is it about the fans that keeps you coming back to conventions and festivals and talking with them and mingling and taking pictures and all of that?
Well, what's really funny about this whole convention thing, I never did conventions. I never did anything like that. And there was a Friday anniversary it was either the 20th or the 15th or 20th. It could have even been the 25th. And I had never done a convention. And there was a thing at the Sony Theater in Hollywood. And it was a whole bunch of us getting together for this, you know, cool thing. And so since I'm out here, they invited me. And well, here I go on stage, and here's Betsy Palmer and Adrian King, both of whom I never met. I never met Larry Lyman. The only, you know, when you're the, as you well know, the only you're a composer, the only person you ever meet is the director and the editor. Sometimes the producer. That's about it. You know, if you went to a party, they all go, "Who's that guy?" It's a composer. Oh yeah, he's like, you know, he didn't do it. You know. Anyway, so here we were on stage there. I'm just going like, "Oh man, Betsy Palmer, how cool!" You know, and Adrian, like, and you know, we just hit it off, you know, all of us together, and. So they're going like, "Oh, you got to come back with us to the convention." And I go, "What convention?" And it's, "Oh, it's right down the street." And, you know, so I go there, and here they all have their table and their pictures and whatever, all different things that they were signing autographs on. And I'm just looking, and people are coming up to me and say, "Oh, man, would you sign this to me? Or would you sign that?" I'm going like, "Sure, I'll sign it. I'll sign it, you know." And you know, Ari and Adrian are going like, "You know, we get paid for this." So like, "Really?" You know, and so they talked me into the, "Oh, you got to do one. So the first one I ever did was in Texas. So, you know, it's really yeah. Texas.
You remember what year?
Yes, no, I don't. I don't remember it, but I know I was sitting next to Kane Hodder, which was a lot of fun, just goofing around with him.
Had you met him prior to that convention?
No.
That was your first time then? Yeah.
And nobody.
Yeah.
Just like you. I don't know these people, you know. You don't see them. You get the movie when it's finished, not, yeah. You know, while it's going on. So, you know, people are coming there, this and that, and I'm signing my name, and people are giving me money, and it's just blowing my mind. Plus, I was hardly charging any money. I think I was charging $15, and everybody else was charging $25. I'm going, $25 for me to write my name? It's crazy. But the people who came up to me, they were just so cool, and they were so... they were honest, and they were just, you know, I realized that they collected things, and this was really important to them. And the more of these I did, the more I understood that the 5 minutes that we have in front of each other is about them. I always try to make it about them. What are you doing? Like, oh this man, I want to know about this. A lot of them come up with their kids, you know, I hang with the kids and keep around with them and everything like that. And I have to tell you, Ari is the guy who came up with the idea for me to write it.
Okay. Write I never knew that.
He said to me, you know, he says, "You got to do more than write your name. You got to do something that makes it special." And I'm going, like, "I don't know. I don't feel anything special, you know." And then all at once I got the idea of just writing out that sound, because that's probably the most identifiable thing. And then it was like, even the people at the convention, when I think it was like on a Sunday, I finally got the idea to do that from, you know, Harry. All at once, the people who I'd already signed something, "Oh, could you come back and put the notes there for them?" I just thought of it, sorry. And so now that's also become a, you know, part of what I do all the time.
And for those that maybe haven't seen or don't know, yeah, you write out the music staff with the treble clef and the music staff, and you write the key, ma, ma, ma notation, and then you sign your name underneath. And I remember the first signing experience, I was sitting next to you in Burbank at Dark Delicacies, and there was a line of Friday the fans. And the first time I saw you do that, I was like, wow, that's really generous. Like, the first guy in line, like, you know, gets this kind of fancy honor. And you did it for everybody in line, like everybody that showed. And I was like, wow, I just thought that was the coolest thing to see somebody like take that much time and to spend with the fans. Yeah.
Well, everybody, and you know, like Adrian, if you look at Adrian, she does something, and the same thing with Eric. It makes it a little bit special. I mean, and I learned a lot from just doing conventions with people who did a lot of Cleveland talk, and they always said, you know, I don't want to hurt my arm patting myself on the back, but I don't think of myself as being that special, you know. Or and here these people are coming up to me like, you know, I'm John Williams, and I'm like, hey, look, I'm happy to meet you. I'm happy that you like this. You know, people, oh, you scored my whole life. I'm kind of like, oh, my God. I'm sorry, you know. Do I have to pay for your therapy or anything? But no, I really enjoy those things. It's so much fun for me.
I love
more than it is almost for the people, you know, who think they're having fun, but I'm having more.
I love, we have those conversations a lot about fandom, because again, I'm a fan. Like, I'm a fan first. I grew up on the films. I'm the person that's standing in line with 150 people getting your autograph, and I really you know, cherish that. And I love helping explain it to you, you know, what the culture is all about, what the fervor is all about, what the excitement is all about, because yeah, there's a lot of Friday fans out there, and they're the best people on the planet, and
you know what? I'll tell a story about you. First of all, this guy is a hell of a composer, and I've heard his music, and I go like, you know, there's a lot of this. He writes a lot like the way I do, and I go like, I gotta watch this guy. He's awfully good, and he's a great writer. I mean, we met on you doing the liner notes for the box set. And I thought what was really funny, we were at this place called Dark Delicacies in Burbank, and there was a signing. So I go there, they were releasing the box set, and, you know, everybody was buying them, blah, blah, blah. So I'm walking on into the place, and the line's out the door down the street. So I walk, and here's Brian standing in line. And I'm going like, what are you doing? And he goes, I'm standing in line. I said, you're not supposed to be in line. You're supposed to be in there with me signing. Well, I didn't do anything. You wrote the liner notes, idiot. Get in there. So he and I sat down next to each other, and of course I had, so, and they're all looking, well, who's this guy? I go, this guy wrote these liner notes. They're fantastic. You know, so, and then there was Adrian and everything. We had a ball.
Yeah.
And you were standing in line.
Yeah, that was an amazing experience, but I still to this day don't know if I should have been up there with you guys, but it's
oh,
great.
No,
it was...
Damn it.
Well, I got one more question for you. So I don't think
one more question. This is so easy, it's ridiculous.
It is easy because we've talked a lot. So we're just talking again. This is just another conversation that it just happened to be recorded and put out to the whole world. So no pressure. But I don't think there's a fan alive on the planet right now that believes Friday the 13th is over. It's been 40 years, but the culture is still thriving. In fact, I'm not even sure if it's peaked yet as far as the fan culture goes, because you're right. The parents that grew up loving Friday are now introducing it to their children, and the whole cycle is just starting over again. There are currently some legal wrinkles that are going on that are being ironed out, but when that happens, it's probably safe to assume that we're going to see another Friday the 13th film sometime in the near future. You've composed music for 8 out of the 12 films to date. Would you like to take a stab at another one someday?
Oh, of course. Of course, I'd like to take a stab. But, the ones that I've seen, other than the ones that followed 10, Jason and Freddy, and then the other... The other ones are called
the 2009, like the reboot, yeah.
Right. I've only seen like minutes of those, like a minute. So I watched a minute, and I was so unimpressed with it, and so I kept saying, like, this is, it's not even Friday. I mean, the person who wrote this understand what the actual thing is about? And so that, I mean, I think I would love to do it. I'd love to take a shot at it, but I would really like it to be, more in keeping with what Friday was going up to Part 10, as opposed to, we talk about this a lot at conventions. I've done a couple of them. One of the funnest was with Adrian and I. We're at a convention, and they were showing Friday the 13th, first one. And what was really cool was we each had a microphone that was live while the film was on, and we were talking over the film, and I was explaining like how I made the music work, and she would say like, oh, I'll never forget this day. It was like a little running dialogue while the film was on. I mean, everybody there had seen the film umpteenth time, but it was really kind of fun. And so, like, for example, there's a scene near the end where, you know, Mrs. Voorhees is chasing Adrian around. And I always said to the audience, I said, one of the things that you're going to watch on Friday the 13th, watch when the music stops and watch when the music starts. I said, because it's very, very important. I said, I am manipulating your fear. I'm working on your fear, and I want you to relax. The more I can get you to relax, the scarier the next thing is going to be. So we came to this one scene, and of course, it's a great scene. It's just Adrian in the kitchen. She's afraid as can be. And in one hand, she has a turkey fork, you know, like a, mm-hmm. a carving fork and a baseball bat, you know. And she's ready for anything, you know, but she doesn't know what's going to happen or what's about to happen. I said, when you're a composer, you have to watch the actors, because the actors are acting, and they really tell you what's going on. So I said, watch Adrian and watch her eyes and just watch what she does. And the music is there, and it's tense, 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 tense. And all at once you see Adrian look, and she goes, she just sighs and lets everything down. And right with the sigh, the music goes out. And music goes out, getting everybody, not only does Adrian relax, but everybody relaxes. Okay, things are going to be okay. Well, you know, 12 seconds later, things are not okay. But nonetheless, that's the way it worked. And then the same thing where Adrian, again, is in the, she's the horror movie, people do crazy things. She's locked herself in the pantry, and outside you can hear Mrs. Voorhees rumbling through the kitchen, not finding her and everything. And then no music. And then all of us, you hear her go away, and there's absolutely no music. And Adrian is lying on the floor, feeling safe. And over her head is the doorknob, right? And I said, watch the doorknob and listen to the music. Soon as the doorknob starts to turn, the music comes up. And it's like, I said, if you just watch the movie, you can see what I'm doing to you through this whole movie. Just, you know, goofing around with your fear. And anyway, when it was over, you know, Adrian and I went back to the hotel. We sat and talked for a while. And I said, you know, That's a hell of a little movie. I mean, you know, the kids in the movie looked like regular kids. They weren't models. Not everybody was good looking. You know, they were just like regular kids, as opposed to like the new ones. Everybody looked like runway models. And the only reason they're there is to, our movie, we actually got to learn about the character. You know, there was a relationship between me, Steve, the guy who's starting the camp, and Adrian. It was set up before. No music, but it was set up so that was going on. I think the one, I think one of my favorite scenes is just before, there's that guy that looks like Kevin Bacon. Is that guy that looks like Kevin Bacon in the movie?
Right.
just before he gets killed, Reem goes into the bathroom that's in the, got to go outside the Ironhouse bathroom. And she's, watching a boob or watching or whatever she's doing, and she breaks into Catherine Hepburn in the mirror. And I'm going like, what does that reveal about the person's character? You don't see that in any of the other movies. These are kids that you knew, that just, there were some that you thought were dirty and you didn't like them, but everybody, had a character and a personality, and it was a story, and when they died, you felt something to them. I said, this is a better movie than you think. I mean, it's not, not Citizen Kane, it's not The Godfather, it's not Donnie Brasco, it's not Groundhog Day.
It's Friday the 13th. I mean,
Lady and the Tramp. It's Friday the 13th, and
it's
that's
Friday the 13th.
Yeah.
In my reach, I've seen the film many times, especially recently since I'm writing the book, and I've had an epiphany in watching the first one recently, where at the end, there's a lot of nostalgia, there's a lot of memories from when I watched it when I was a kid and I was scared and all that, but rewatching it again, I just had an epiphany. It's like, I felt the same thing. Like, this is a hell of a movie. This is a genuinely clever, crafty, well-done picture. And I think that's why it stands the test of time 40 years later. I don't think it's an accident. I don't think it's a coincidence. There are reasons why that film endured for 40 years. And I think we touched on some of those things.
Well, and there's a whole influence. Is that the word? I know you're the wordsmith. Of energy.
Yeah.
You had Tom Savini, that literally just absolutely the most amazing effects, real effects for that time.
Yeah.
They were astonishing. You had the whole thing that came together. The editing in that picture is one of the things that I think sometimes goes by the wayside.
Mm-hmm.
The last scene where Adrian is in the boat, I always make a joke about it. I said, there's horror fans and then there's just film fans. And she's out in the boat. And I had to come up with it, which was really funny. I had to come up with a lovely piece of music to make it sound like the movie was over. So I actually just took the country song from the bar and played it slower. It sounded like the credits were really rewarded. And they just kept extending that shot and extending that shot to the point of where, the amateur horror film fans, they gave up. Then there were like horror film fans, they gave up. And then there were the people who saw Carrie, and they were like, something about that. And even they gave up before Jason comes out of the water. I mean, that editing, they stretched it to the point of where literally they got everybody to give up. on anything else they want.
And it still works to this day. The movie plays in a theater today, and half the theater is going to jump. I mean, even if you've seen it before, you're still going to jump.
Right.
It's fantastic.
There's a lot of stuff that went into that movie. Magic, lightning in a bottle.
Yeah, and I agree, and I believe music is one of them. That's why I've kind of dedicated the last couple years of my life to writing about it and showcasing to the world, because I think the music is exceptional, not just in the first one, but all the films as they continue through the series. They kind of get better and better, which is what I love about your work in the subsequent films. But it all started with that first one. And I love, you mentioned it earlier in the conversation, my favorite thing about the score is the whole entire score, not just the first film, but the later sequels, which is based off the same material, can all be reduced down to one single sonority. When you play that sonority on the piano, it sounds like Friday the 13th.
Yeah, it's Friday the 13th.
Yep.
It all comes down to that one thing.
Yeah. And I think that's one thing that's kind of missing from modern film music, is that you can play a chord and go, oh, that's the score for this film or that film. You play that Friday chord, boom. People may not even know they're hearing it, but like, well, that sounds like Friday the 13th. Like, well, there's a reason for that.
Right, yeah, it is. It's always there.
Yeah. Yeah.
It's there in one way or another. Sometimes I take it out.
Yeah, yeah. Well, Harry, I could talk to you for hours. I always enjoy doing it, but we're going to go ahead. We have, yes. But we're gonna wrap this up for today. I want to thank you for joining me and joining us here at the festival. It's always a pleasure speaking with you, and I just want to thank you for coming.
Well, thank you, and I'll tell you, I can't wait for next year because you have to come to the festival.
I'm going to be there. I'm going to put it in my calendar. My book should be done by then. It should be out by then, so we'll have something to celebrate maybe, and I can't wait. It's going to be great.